My name is Michael Cates, professor of microbiology in the School of Medicine. Arrived in Seattle in 1987, studying probably a dozen different viruses over that time frame. Been studying influenza for over a quarter century. This strain of virus is a very unusual type of swine flu. Perhaps that's one reason why they want to call it H1N1, amongst some other reasons. But this is a virus that has genes from three different species, from birds, from humans, and from pigs. So it's a highly unusual virus, and it's the first time a virus like this has been observed. And the answer is nobody knows. Now we can get different clues about that. For example, what happens in the Southern Hemisphere? So we're entering the flu season for the Southern Hemisphere. The virus has already been isolated in the Southern Hemisphere, so we'll be able to get some idea about the prevalence of the virus or the transmissibility of the virus as we look into our summer and the Southern Hemisphere winter. So, and that'll give us a clue, but nobody really knows. In 1918, however, there was a mild wave of the virus around this time of year, and essentially the same exact virus reappeared in the flu season in the fall, and that's when it did its most damage, killing 50 million people. Well, in 1918, the first outbreak was fairly mild. There were very few deaths, very similar to what's going on now with the swine flu in 2009. The virus that came back in October, November, when it did its most damage, the second wave, was essentially the identical virus, and it killed most of the people it killed during that second wave. There was then a third wave in the spring, which was much more milder. The interesting thing about that was that it was essentially the identical viruses that appeared all three times. So one reason that people are concerned today is that if the swine flu comes back, even in its present form, it could do a lot of damage. So it's very important to be developing a good vaccine, which I think is going ahead. So the question is, why was 1918 so lethal? And could a virus like that come back and cause equal damage? In 1918, they didn't even know it was a virus. So there were no antiviral drugs, there were no vaccines. We were in the midst of World War I. So it was a different time. It's an interesting virus because it also caused dramatic changes in the way the United States set up its research. The National Institutes of Health was influenced by the pandemic. Today, it's a different time. I think we're better prepared. We have drugs that work against this swine flu. We'll have a vaccine that will work against the swine flu. So I think we're in a much better position. Does that mean people should be complacent? No. I think that if there is a vaccine that is effective, we should all get vaccinated. I think that high-risk populations should make sure they have access to antiviral drugs. Keep in mind that these viruses do a lot of damage in people who are not healthy, people who are immunocompromised, such as AIDS patients. So I think that we have to remain vigilant and we have to take advantage of what modern healthcare can provide. So the question is, how quickly and how effective could vaccine development occur? And I think using modern technologies, we could be prepared for an outbreak in the fall. I think, you know, one of the main questions is, will the virus mutate to such a point where the vaccine won't be protective? And that, of course, we can't predict. If it mutates slightly and the vaccine is partially effective, then that's much better than a non-effective vaccine or not getting vaccinated at all. Rumor has it that they're going to be giving you three vaccines in the fall, one for seasonal flu, like we've been getting each year, and two for swine flu. So I think we'll see what happens as the manufacturing occurs and as people get a better idea of how virulent this virus really is. What people should be aware of is that we know very little about how these viruses operate. We know very little relative to how they cause disease, and people have to be vigilant. They have to be prepared, They have to be educated. They have to know when there's a possible vaccine or there are possible drugs. And even though a virus like influenza has 8 genes and we have 25,000 genes, it doesn't mean that we know more or we know better. These viruses are incredibly clever, incredibly highly evolved, and people just have to be able to respect what they can do.